Philippine Central Bank data show bank lending expanded by 12.2% in August, with consumer loans in particular expanding by 18.3%, faster than the 14.7% growth seen the month before. Credit card growth expanded 24.4% year-on-year. Salary loans, that grew 51.9%. We should get an update on those numbers today from the Philippine Central Bank. UK-based think tank Pantheon Macroeconomics was quoted saying this trend of Filipino consumers turning to debt to fund day-to-day spending is not a long-term solution. Let's get the take of Nicholas Mapa, senior economist at ING Bank Manila. Nicky, good morning.
Good morning, Warren, and thanks for having me on.
Thanks for joining us. So, again, we're going to get the latest data on those lending numbers today. It should be out from the BSP. But what's your take on those spikes, particularly salary loans? That's a big increase year on year.
Yeah, Warren, that's a great topic that you guys picked up. One thing we've seen throughout the pandemic, this isn't just now, households have been able to sort of fund their purchases through a combination of salary-based loans as well as credit card debt. Given the downturn that we saw, the recession in 2020, 2021, bank lending fell quite precipitously into negative territory, but it was just salary loans and credit card lending that pretty much stayed positive or in bouts of negative. But these were the two, components of bank lending that were relatively still up and about during the pandemic, showing us that households were sort of resorting to borrowing from banks, salary-based loans and credit cards to fund even basic purchases. Now, some people might be thinking, oh, people are just buying stuff on Lazada or online. But, based on the BSP's consumer expectation survey, 50% or higher were funding purchases of basic goods and necessities. So this is pretty much their lifeline throughout the pandemic, and it's continuing to do so, I think, because we see how inflation's been moving over the past few months. Now, with the BSP sort of hinting that they'll have to raise the cap on credit cards, we could see this take a bit of a downturn if those rates are raised.
Yeah, and considering again, maybe it may have made sense, as you mentioned, that earlier in the pandemic to use your credit card to pay for things like groceries when interest rates were so low. I mean, well, I guess credit card interest rates though are sort of fixed at that point, but salary loans and that sort of thing, these things tend to move alongside the rate policy, the policy rate of the BSP. Now these rates are moving higher. What do you think? Is this going to, in the past, because of the low bank percentage of banked individuals here in the Philippines, we could just shrug off any policy moves. But here, we're looking at households borrowing more. So does this mean more pain when the BSP interest rates again?
Hikes rates. Yeah, I mean, this is going to start to take its toll on households. In the next few months, BSP always says it takes about 6 to 18 months for policy lag to kick in. But I think this should start to really, households will start to feel a pinch in the next few months with inflation here in the Philippines and I guess the rest of the world really searing hot. One thing I also wanted to point out, which is one thing we found out in one of our recent studies, is that throughout the pandemic, households resorting to all this debt, a lot of them are also dipping into their savings. So households indicated in the consumer expectation survey that they're now less able to set aside money for savings. So you have a sort of a situation where households have lower debt levels or have been able to save less at the same time resorting to credit just to fund basic purchases. With rates on the way up and with inflation still elevated, we could see a sharp slowdown in consumption in the next few months.
Yeah, and let's talk about inflation, 6.9%, the previous reading. Mm-hmm. When do you think it's going to peak? Everybody's been asking that question. Some people are saying this month. Some people are saying, it's going to remain really elevated all the way till December. What's your take on that?
Yeah, we see inflation easily cresting the 7% handle next month and probably peaking November or December. What we're seeing right now is sort of like the double whammy of both cost push and supply side pressures coming to fore. And one thing that we want to highlight is the fact that once these second round effects start and they have started to really come out of the woodwork, it tends to really spiral and sort of we get into a situation where inflation starts to sort of build. Wage adjustments, transport fare hikes, as well as all these other industries. I think we saw it earlier in the program bread producers now asking for the chance to increase their prices because, you know, everything's starting to feed off on itself. You know, BSP governor coming out today, early this morning, saying that he will act decisively, flagging another punchy rate hike at their next meeting. So BSP is trying its best to sort of corral inflation expectations, and I think it's a good move to try to combat or allay some of the concerns about inflation for now.
So let's talk about non-performing loans, bad loans. You say that this credit card borrowing and salary loans, this has been happening throughout the pandemic. Now inflation is going up. Policy rates are going up. There are no savings. Incomes, they're not moving that much. So the ability of these households to pay off this debt, which has been, really growing, it's not that good right now.
Yeah, those are all great points, Warren. However, I guess the silver lining here is that the economy is much better footing than it was in 2021. 2021, we were still pretty much in recession. The job market was very challenging. Nowadays, the job market has improved. Still some room for improvement. However, underemployment is high, but the unemployment rate has come off quite a bit. This tells us that, yes, we're seeing some people picked up a lot of debt over the past few years or months. Interest rates are rising, high inflation, but at least we have job creation, at least on the uptrend. That should help. And one thing that's helping keep NPLs down, actually it's on the downtrend, is because people are able to service these loans because they're able to find jobs nowadays.
All right. But again, considering all of those factors that we mentioned, do you think consumer loans are going to slow down anytime soon?
Well, one thing we noted is that car sales are out through the roof. If you look at their 64% in the last month. One thing we have noticed also is that bank lending or motor vehicle loans have not picked up quite so. So throughout the pandemic, we saw salary loans and credit cards sort of the go-to move for consumer credit. We could see that decelerate as inflation picks up. But, with everyone's, or at least the strong demand for cars, we might see that offset by some improvement in motor vehicle loans. It's a very challenging environment. But yes, the economy is in much better footing. Hopefully that can help offset some of the challenges that we're facing in the near term.
Yeah, it's tough, though. But let's take a look at the other side of the equation. Banks, it's really an unsure environment right now, but at least it looks like they can count on consumer lending. How will this impact the bottom line of banks moving forward? And, just going back into the picture from looking at the picture from the point of view of investors.
So interest rates rising actually quite positive for banks, I think. At the same time, even if interest rates have been on the uptick, bank lending stays positive. And now we're seeing sort of productive loans coming into the form. Throughout the pandemic, it was consumer loans. During recession, you saw a lot of banks holding off on new lending to ventures because, people are pretty much on the sidelines, increased risk environment. But now that, the economy is on much better footing, we're seeing a lot more lending to firms, to businesses, as, people are trying to get their companies back into expansion mode.
Yeah, economists like yourself always like to look at the loan growth as for signs of the economy moving forward. But again, going back to the consumers and the way that this pandemic has treated them, it's tough to think that these people are in a good situation right now.
Yeah, it's going to be a very challenging time, and I think one of the reasons why BSP tried to keep its handle on interest rates for so long, just to provide them a little more leeway, a little more breathing room. But now I think with what's happening in the world economy, the BSP has to resort to rate hikes. Unfortunately, this will add a challenging environment for households. But once again, the silver lining there is that the jobs market is so much better now. BSP and I guess the rest of the government has been able to provide enough support throughout the the worst times of the pandemic. And now that the economy is in much better footing because of that support, hopefully that can offset to some extent the challenging environment on prices, challenging environment on interest rates.
Yeah, those households have to get their hands on those fixed rate loans, right? We have two more policy meetings, November and December. What's your forecast for that?
Yeah, well, initially we priced in 100 basis points total. So we were looking at a 50 basis points in November and another 50 basis points in December. BSP Governor Medalla saying maybe he does 75 in November. That's also warranted. I think if you get ahead of the curve, if you need to hike by 100, might as well do a little more early on. Just to sort of allay concerns about the currency, allay fears about inflation. At the same time, yeah, just try to project that, the BSP is in full inflation fighting mode. So at least a 50 basis point in November, but now looking possibly at a 75 basis point rate hike by Governor Medalla.
Yeah, you said 100 earlier, possibly 100 in November.
100 total for the year.
Okay, 100 total.
Maybe they front load a 75 for November and then 25 or maybe 50 if warranted. But once again, Governor Medalla gave a caveat to all of this. A lot of this depends on where the Fed will be. So we'll likely just take our cue from the Fed in the next 2 meetings.
Yeah, it'd be very interesting to see what happens in the next policy rate setting meeting. One last question for you. The dollar peso exchange rate, it's been dancing with 60 for some time now. What do you think is going to happen with that moving forward?
Well, the BSP sort of vowed to just, try to smooth out some of the volatility in the market. There are a lot of, some factors that would add depreciation pressure on the peso. But there are some silver linings or hopes that they can offset some of that. We have remittance season coming in. Hopefully that's enough to offset the depreciation pressure on the peso. BSP is going to be there to smooth out volatility, and we'll see how that plays out towards the end of the year.
Thank you so much for your time this morning. Nicholas Mapa, Senior Economist at ING Bank, Manila.